of the talk that I plan to give today is called Brain-Based Values. And I realized after being here that it's actually a rather parochial title. But in America, it actually carries a certain amount of significance, because for the last 8 or perhaps 10 years, there has been rather heavy talk coming from especially the, as they call them, the evangelical right, concerning faith-based values. And so by calling this brain-based values, what I really had intended to do was to sort of draw attention to the possibility that we can begin to talk about the fundamentals and the basics of moral behavior from a naturalistic point of view. And by naturalistic, I just mean a point of view that embraces really all of science and doesn't particularly appeal to anything supernatural. And I'll have a little bit more to say about that as we go on. In this first slide, I wanted to depict sort of the state of play about, maybe a decade or 15 years ago, where there was a certain amount of interaction between evolutionary biology, genetics and anthropology on the one hand, neuroscience on the other hand, and it had a, there was a little bit of interaction between those who were doing moral philosophy and those who were also interested, especially in the criminal law and in social policy. But the connection, I think, was very tentative, and it was very infrequent. By and large, these disciplines tended to be isolated from one another, although I think it was recognized, especially in these two groups, that ultimately it was likely that the connections would get increasingly stronger. And that has indeed happened over the last decade. And so now we see that as a result mainly of a range of empirical discoveries, that we have begun to really make connections between evolutionary biology and genetics and neuroscience. And that has also really awakened interest, especially in jurisprudence and people who are interested in the criminal law. I was surprised to discover, for example, about 2 months ago that I received an invitation from the committee who runs an education course for California judges, of whom there are 1,400 California judges, Supreme Court, appellate court, the whole thing, along with a certain number of prosecutors. And they wanted to learn about neuroscience. Mm-hmm. And so a number of us went to this meeting. And we had a very lively and very interesting discussion. And from my perspective, this has been an immensely fruitful development, and it has given us, I think, a quite new perspective, one that reaches back to ideas certainly that Aristotle had, but also ideas about social policy and ethics that we see in Hume, that we see in Locke, and others more recently. So let's just begin in a simple sort of way, where we ask the kind of question that actually Socrates asked in his discussion with Euthyphro. Where do moral principles come from? The normative seems very different from the descriptive or the factual. Where does it come from? If it isn't out there to be simply discovered, in the way that certain kinds of plants, let us say, are out there to be discovered, where do they come from? Is it possible then that the normative, the moral rules come from divine authority? As you know, in one of the sort of rich and great discussions in the philosophical history, Socrates and Euthyphro really basically duked it out. Socrates says, so Euthyphro, you're on your way to prosecute your father, and, you know, well, what makes something right? And Euthyphro, of course, arrogant and full of confidence, says, well, what is right is what the gods say is right. And Socrates says, well, you know, is it right because the gods say it? That is, does the God saying it make it right? And Israel says, yeah, that's it, all right. And then, of course, Socrates says, you mean that if the gods said, this is my embellishment now, that taking your firstborn and boiling it was an essential thing to do, that that would be right? Don't be a miserable fool, Socrates, you know, grow up. Oh, well, fine, then do the gods say it's right because it is right? Oh, yes, that's definitely it, says Euthyphro. In which case, Socrates says, well, then the gods are really nothing but a mouthpiece for our understanding of what is and what isn't moral. Now, of course, there's much more to be said about that argument. It is deeper, I think, much deeper, actually, than I presented it here as being. But it's always been, since, a thorn in the side of those who want to say that norms originate in defined authority. Pure reason, since perhaps this is not going to satisfy us, pure reason has also been appealed to and continues to be appealed to as the source of moral knowledge. And this is appealing in some ways and not appealing in other ways. Part of the difficulty is, of course, that people can reason and come to reasonable conclusions that do not necessarily agree. The other thing is that pure reason has come in for rather a poor show recently, because we know that emotional components in moral reasoning and in practical reasoning more generally are essential for making good, wise, practical decisions. Moral intuition, actually, although it was very unfashionable for much of the 20th century, moral intuition has had kind of a revival, and it's had kind of a revival for reasons that I'm going to talk about. Hume, of course, was one of the people who thought that moral intuition, guided naturally by your experiences in the world, the social and the natural world, guided by teaching and learning, but moral intuition probably serves quite well, by and large, or about as well as anything can. Now, beginning about the 1970s, within evolutionary biology and genetics, there was an increasing interest in trying to understand the basis of cooperative behavior. And this was, of course, because we had understood by that time that fundamentally genes are selfish. That is, that in order to explain the proliferation of a gene, you have to do it in terms of reproductive success, which has a wider context of competitive success. And so it was hard to see in the beginning how you might ever explain cooperative behavior. And some people, some philosophers, wanted to say, well, that's okay, because we humans just have moral understanding in contrast to the animals, and it comes from the fact that we have this glorious tool called pure reason. But the evolutionary biologists then began to model what it would take for a trait for cooperation and sharing and altruism to spread spread throughout a population. And basically, and I'm going to boil this down to a very simple story, they said that, first of all, members have to be able to identify each other as individuals, and they have to detect and remember the non-cooperators. You also have to be able to detect deception, when it is that someone is pretending to cooperate that's actually going to cheat, and you have to shun and punish the non-cooperators. And under those conditions, it will turn out that a trait will spread throughout the population. Now, the part about detecting and remembering non-cooperators got a real boost from the animal behaviorists who looked at vampire bats. And one of the things that they discovered about vampire bats is that they have very strict rules about reciprocity. So reciprocity is actually sort of built into this. But in any case, what they discovered about the vampire bats was as follows. That a vampire bat must have a blood meal every night. And typically, they leave the cave, they find some ungulate or a cow or what have you, and they get their blood meal, they go back to the cave, hang upside down, digest, and they're fine. Occasionally, a particular vampire bat will be unlucky and will come back to the cave without a blood meal. If he doesn't have that blood meal, however, he's going to die. And what has evolved amongst vampire bats, and presumably this is a very, very old adaptation, is the following. The hungry bat will come back and will tap another bat who did get a blood meal. And that bat will regurgitate some of his meal for the bat, and both will manage to survive the night. Here's the interesting part of the story. Suppose he taps this one, and that bat, nice and fat from his meal and quite happy, refuses to regurgitate. All the bats remember that incident. So when that bat, it may take a while, but when that bat comes back hungry, no bat will regurgitate for him. Which is a very interesting characterization of what you need to have a social trait spread. If he can't survive, he can't reproduce, and that sort of social behavior dies out. And consequently, it is in fact extremely rare now amongst vampire bats to see failure to reciprocate. Now, there are many, many kinds of social animals. Ed Wilson taught us a lot about sociability in something like ants. I think these ones are particularly interesting. They're working together to pull leaves together so that they can make a shelter. They have to work together, and they get the benefits of working together. And if someone isn't pulling his weight, then he is not able to participate in the benefits of sociability. And of course, what was obvious to most animal behaviorists is that there are tremendous benefits to sociability. Benefits in sharing food, as the vampire bats do, benefits in defense, benefits in sharing certain aspects of life, like sharing raising young, and also sharing in various kinds of tasks, as we do. It's been known for a long time that a lone chimpanzee has a very short life. If he lives in the troop and he's able to share and partake, he lives and does quite well. A lone wolf, similarly, does very well as long as he's in the pack. If he's on his own, he can't get the kind of food that the pack can. The pack can bring down the caribou, he has to scrounge for mice. And they very quickly manage to pass on. And so here we have also, everyone knows, of course, that wolves are social animals, and dogs, which have been bred from wolves, have a really remarkable kind of sociability that humans have bred them to have. Now, the other thing that's significant about studies in animal behavior, as they linked up with studies in molecular biology and studies in neurobiology and animal behavior more generally, is that there are connections between genes and culture, genes and learning and culture. We know, for example, that when you learn something, there is upregulation of certain genes, and those genes express themselves and the learning consolidates. So there's a very important relation between genes, gene expression, and learning. There's a very important relation also between genes and culture. We all understand very well now that the division that was popular in the last century between nature and nurture is nothing like as clean and clear-cut as was then supposed, that the expression of many genes depends on what's going on epigenetically. And we saw this yesterday when I talked about the expression of genes for oxytocin. If the rat pups are removed from the mother and nurtured well, but not licked and groomed and so forth in the normal way, then there is a change in the expression of the genes for oxytocin and less in the way of oxytocin and that oxytocin receptors are produced. It's also the case that in those conditions where the very young are removed from the mother, even though they're fed well and given all of the normal things that you would think, there's another kind of gene expression that kicks in, and it's gene expression for the receptors for the glucocorticoids, which means that such animals tend not only to be missocialized and have difficulty acquiring social skills, but they also tend on the whole to be more anxious. Because after all, they have more receptors for the glucocorticoids, and that's going to affect their autonomic system, which is what makes them anxious. So we know that there's this very interesting, complicated relationship between all of these things. So however we want to think about sociability, it's important not to think that it's going to be a simple relationship between, you know, having a gene and performing the behavior, because there's all of this big thing in between, namely the brain, and aspects of brain organization and circuitry are going to be affected by how genes are expressed, which is affected by what happens in the environment. So it's a very complex relationship. And I think this is, it's really important actually to think about that, because there has been a tendency to talk about genetic determinism. You have the gene for sociability, you're going to be nice. It doesn't work that way. Those little rat pups who are removed from the mother have the gene for sociability, in the sense that if they're licked and groomed and brought up with other pups and so forth, they will be able to acquire social skills. But that's a very different story from saying, if you have the gene, you're going to do the behavior. So, what's happened then, really, to change, and I adverted to this yesterday, to change the scene is that the models produced by evolutionary biology and animal behavior people have developed, in addition, because there have been these wonderful developments in neuroscience and in the study of animal behavior. One of the things we know then is that, like these guys, cats, we are social creatures. That trustworthiness is a value. Humans on their own, absolutely on their own, are like chimps, absolutely on their own. They do not do well. We do much better if we can depend on one another in all of the manifest and complicated ways that we do. Social isolation, in other words, is a cost. It's a real cost. And you know that, in a way, intuitively, because shunning and ostracizing has always been something that is very painful for normal people. And that's why something like ostracization was, and exile was used as a punishment. It's very painful. And untrustworthiness, then, is a cost. And we saw from the vampire bats what kind of cost it is. Now, obviously, in the human community, the cost is reckoned in a much more complicated way. But a cost, nevertheless, it is. We know a little bit now, and this uses a slide that I also used yesterday, but we know a little bit more now about the pathways and the neurons and the neurochemicals that regulate sociability. But I want to emphasize that this is only the beginning of the story. But it's an important beginning because it opens doors for us and doors that were not open really until very recently. Subcortical structures, including the amygdala, which is especially important for processing signals having to do with threat and fear. The nucleus accumbens, which is especially important for processing and regulating signals of reward, but also signals for punishment. And incidentally, those are context sensitive. And we can see that in rat physiological studies. Sometimes what is rewarding will, in a different context for that rat, actually be punishing. Which, of course, makes sense. But it makes you realize that these structures are not sort of simple reflex off on kinds of things. Other structures, the ventral tegmental area is a structure in the brainstem that produces dopamine via its neuronal projections to many, many areas. This, I believe, is the septum. Yeah, there we are, the septum. The hypothalamus is in here, but it's hard to kind of see amongst other things. These are the important subcortical structures, along with something that isn't actually shown here, and that's the basal ganglia, which it turned out, to everybody's surprise, are very, very important for processing reward signals and kind of integrating across a range of sensory and motor signals to handle the issue of reward. Exactly how this is done is not known, but it came about as a complete surprise. Everybody until Wolfram Schultz and his graduate students in about 1989, I think, thought that the basal ganglia was essentially a motor structure. And they thought so too. And they were trying to work on motor control in the basal ganglia. And they couldn't get any responses out of the neuron. And somebody thought the monkey was just kind of getting bored and they better do something. They gave him an apple. And all of a sudden the neuron went brrr. And they realized for the very first time that maybe this was actually a reward-sensitive neuron, which indeed we now know the basal ganglia neurons are. Okay, so the background then is that the big missing piece of the puzzle that would take us from just so stories or how possibly stories to probably this is the way it works is the story of how the brain mediates and regulates social behavior. I just want to show this, not because I'm going to go into great detail, but because the cortex is often thought of as the thing that makes us what we really are and all the rest is just kind of there to hold the cortex up. I want to kind of indicate to you that in my view the cortex is interesting, but the real action is all subcortical. And the cortex can do very sophisticated things so long as these other structures are doing what they do. So this is the brainstem with a whole lot of different nuclei and pathways, and this just shows a slightly different version of it. We don't need to go into detail, but suffice it to say that there are structures in the brainstem that are acutely sensitive to things like blood pressure, temperature, plasma levels, glucose levels, oxygen levels, carbon dioxide levels. And when you are in a swimming pool and you're down a little longer than you should be and you begin to get that panicky feeling in your chest, it's not your cortex that's telling you you need oxygen. It's the brain stem. Okay. Now, Darwin actually, in The Descent of Man, made the observation that he thought that sociability, as we see it in humans, and as we see it more generally in mammals, probably had something to do with its origins. In other words, it was an extension of something that we do see kind of new with mammals, namely nursing and parental care. Turtles lay their eggs in the sand and mama's off, and the baby turtles are left to fend for themselves. Not quite so bad with alligators. They'll lay their eggs in the sand, they'll wait for them to hatch, then they'll help them into the ocean one by one. Actually, what they do is it's quite remarkable. They pick them up, these great, huge jaws with all these teeth, and they pick up a baby alligator and go down to the ocean, deposit it, and come back for another. But once they're in the ocean, they're on their own. Now, with birds, of course, we also see nursing and parental care, but in birds, we also see extraordinarily sophisticated social behavior. And I'll maybe have a chance to talk about birds later. Paul McLean, who really was the person most responsible in the last century for drawing attention to subcortical structures, and he called the limbic system, the ones I depicted earlier, made a similar point that what's new with mammals is nursing, of course, and really intensive parental care. Playful behavior, which of course has to do with learning sociability, separation vocalization. we also see missing birds. The parents are gone. The pup needs the parents and it will cry out. And mate attachment. And we saw yesterday a little bit about the voles, but for those of you who weren't here, I'll say a little bit more about it. So there are two particular peptides that we think are very important amongst many other neurochemicals for regulating social behavior. They're relatively simple peptides. This one is oxytocin. These are in no sense new with mammals. They're not even new with insects. Oxytocin had been known, even in the 1970s, as something that was released in the milk when the baby was nursing. It had also been known to be important for the contractions that are necessary in the uterus for delivery and the contractions necessary in mammary tissue for release of the milk. But it turns out that something else happens in this situation, and that is in the infant's brain, in this warm, comforting, cuddling situation, oxytocin is released, and the genes for making oxytocin receptors are expressed, and similarly in the case of the mother. Big chemical changes. It also appears to be the case that when animals groom each other, and of course grooming is extremely important for animals who live in hot places and who have pelts because they get all kinds of parasites. Oxytocin is released both in the groomee and in the groomer. They both get quite a lot out of it. We used to think that the group for the groomer was a cost. Turns out, actually, to everybody's surprise, that the groomer feels really good about this whole business. Now, just briefly to recapitulate yesterday, there are two kinds of voles. Prairie voles are monogamous pair bonders and are biparental. Montane voles are promiscuous bonders and are monoparental. The brains differ in important respects, and the brains differ precisely with regard to receptors for those peptides, vasopressin and oxytocin. In the female prairie vole, the nucleus accumbens contains a much higher density of receptors for oxytocin. So when she has that first mating with her chap, with her prairie vole, she gets this flood of oxytocin which binds to the nucleus accumbens, which is part of the reward system. So she not only feels great, but next time she even sees him, she feels great. She feels desirable. And in the male, in a region, again, subcortical, called the ventral pallidum, there is a much higher density of receptors for vasopressin. So it's kind of the mirror image, but in a different part of the brain. And he feels bonded to her. And the other thing is that they will both defend the nest against any kind of intruders. She will also defend him against other females that are interested, and vice versa. It's quite interesting. Although, it actually, you know, so we all thought for pretty much until a couple of months ago, I guess, that because they are monogamous pair bonders, meaning that they bond for life, so if you follow them year after year after year, and they don't live that long, but they're always together. But actually, there is a certain amount of philandering, because other pups in the community will end up carrying some of this guy's genes. So it turns out that monogamous pair bonding, and this is probably true of humans also, is actually consistent with a certain amount of sexual activity outside the bond, but they nevertheless bond mainly for life. But that's not because we're cool in here, is it? Okay. Oh, I see. Yes, of course, the prince. All right. And as I explained yesterday, the genes for this have been found, and we know what regulates expression of the genes, and the story is beginning to really fall into place. So, another part, I think, of the story human sociability that was, and mammalian sociability that I mentioned yesterday, has to do with the fact that oxytocin seems to actually play quite an important role in trust as well. And so there have been really quite accurate measures of trusting behavior in rats when the females have a lot of oxytocin and when they don't, and so forth. But basically, you see greater levels of trusting behavior when there are fairly substantial levels of oxytocin. So it looks like there's great benefits from living in social groups, but that there are certain costs, and some of the costs mean that you have to help others when you might prefer not to, but that it's definitely in your long-term interest to do so, although you probably don't calculate that. Right? You're just built that way. So it may feel right, and you may feel guilty if you don't do it, but that's really not to be thought of, I think, in terms of a sort of detached calculation of what is and isn't your interest. It's really nature's way of making sure that you're going to fit in and manage to be a well-tuned social animal. The social behavior of many animals has been studied really quite intensively, and so part of what has really contributed to this revolution in understanding social behavior are the results that people have brought back from studying baboons in Africa, chimps in Africa, wolves in the north, caribou in the north, and so forth. But there do seem to be things about human sociability that we share with them, but there are also some things that are really rather different. And part of what we would like to do, and this will be the really speculative part of this talk, what we would like to do is to be able to explain human-style social behavior. Now, what do I mean by that? In our closest relatives, for example, chimps and gorillas, orangs, possibly monkeys, baboons, by and large, cooperation and sharing is done within a fairly small group where the animals are largely kin related. So for example, in a chimpanzee troop, the males are pretty much all related to one another. The young females leave and join a new troop, and other females come in and join this troop. But the males are by and large pretty much related to each other. And so using the basic biological models of kin selection and how helping my kin actually helps my genes, we can understand that, and it makes perfectly good biological sense. But humans also do something else, and that is they help perfect strangers. They sometimes help people who they will never see and have no expectation of any kind of reciprocity, who are not even part of the group. For example, lots of people give blood. It's not a huge sacrifice. On the other hand, it is an inconvenience. It is a cost. And you will almost certainly never see the person who will benefit from this particular gift. We also tend to feel almost automatically, without thinking about it, that if an unknown child is in trouble or lying face down in a pool, we would always take it out. It's not true with chimpanzees and baboons. So one of the big questions then has been, what is it about sociability in humans that is a little bit different? And I'm going to argue that there are a number of pieces of the puzzle, and at first they're not going to seem related. But my job will be to try to argue how they're related, and why it brings us a little bit closer to understanding human social behavior. The first piece of the puzzle I owe to evolutionary biologist Sam Bowl, who has designed models based on data about what we do know about Aboriginal groups to to show that altruism and lethal intergroup competition almost certainly co-evolved. Now that's a kind of surprise if it's true, but of course he only has a model of how that might be true. The data on Aboriginal people is also similar in really surprising and interesting ways to the data on chimpanzee troops. And here are the data. Chimpanzee troops, especially when they reach a certain size, and you've got all these males who are kin-related, and they are on the border of the territory of another group, have, and this has been demonstrated now many times in many different groups, will do the following. They're doing quite well, and of an evening, the males will very quietly get together and wander quietly off in a completely distinct way from what they do when they are going hunting a monkey, for example. And then they kind of congregate, and they go, this is work all done by Richard Wrangham at Harvard. They go to the border of the territory, and they try to find a lone chimp from the neighboring troop, and then they kill it. They often do it in the most brutal way imaginable. They bite, they kick, they could kill it quickly, they don't. Sometimes a female or two would come along and watch, cheer from the sideline. And sometimes they will just rip great chunks of flesh out and then leave it to die. Sometimes they kill it, but they often just leave it to die. And so there's a lot of kicking, and of course they've got very sharp teeth, and it's a very nasty business. And then they do it again the next night. And eventually, in the troop that Wrangham was studying, they managed to kill all of the chimps in the neighboring troop. Now, the males are all related. What we never see in baboons is that sort of intergroup competition, the lethal group competition. Baboons, of course, are completely different. The males leave the troop, and the females are all connected. And when one troop of baboons is close by another one, they tend to sort of acknowledge each other and go their separate ways. Now, in the anthropology on Aboriginal groups, especially as this has been done in South America, show something really quite similar. That these rather small groups will attack, the men will get together of a pleasant evening and will go along sneakily and will encounter, say, a couple of children and a mother, and they'll just kill them and then go back. In any case, this is motivated. There's plenty of literature out there, so you can Google lethal group intercompetition in humans and you'll come up with a lot. This motivated Bowles to think that it may have been in the ancestral condition that there was a lot of lethal intergroup competition, not unlike what we see in the Pantrolopithecines. And the other part of his hypothesis, and this was what sort of caught my attention, was if this group is big enough and strong enough, so they figure they can attack that group, kill them all, then the altruism part of the story comes in because now they should share the spoils. Well, that seemed like kind of a good idea, but it didn't quite make it for me. It's not really quite there. I mean, how would that gene spread throughout a population in the beginning? I'm going to come back to increasing group size in a moment. Now, the other piece of the puzzle that I think is important has to do with mimicry. So, now this is going to, as I said, this is going to seem unrelated, but it's not. It turns out that when people first encounter each other, especially as strangers, and they are motivated to get along for some reason or other, there is quite a substantial degree of non-conscious mimicry of small mannerisms, of facial expressions, of postures, even of particular expressions of words. Having observed this, and I think many people in a casual way have observed this, Kim Barg and Tanya Chartrand decided to look at it very systematically. And what they found was really quite interesting. So if you put an undergraduate and a Confederate in a room and they're supposed to be working together on a task, and you say, you don't tell them anything about unconscious mimicry, they just work on the task, it turns out that if the Confederate in minor ways imitates, and very subtly imitates the student, the experimental subject, and then the experimental subject is interviewed afterwards, they say things like, well, he seemed like such a nice guy. I mean, you know, I felt like we really connected, and he was really smart. It was a great guy. If he does it, the same guy restrains himself from any kind of imitation, and now we're interviewing the experimental subject. The subject says, well, he was okay, I guess. He was kind of creepy, actually. I don't know, there was just something about him. I just couldn't get comfortable. It was just weird. I'm really sorry. I hope it's not offending him. You know, so, but they don't know, either of them, that had anything to do with unconscious mimicry. So they've done a gazillion experiments on this phenomenon. Now, the one that I was particularly interested in goes like this. So, what we're going to do is to make the experimental subject a little concerned about her sociability. And the way we do this is we initially have her play a video game of catch with two other people. And initially everybody gets the ball and throws it back on the computer. And then after a while, Confederates mainly just play ball between themselves, and she doesn't get it very well. So this goes on for a few minutes. And now we put her into the room with the Confederate, and her unconscious mimicry of him goes way up from what it is if there is no preparation of that kind. So not only do we like it when we are mimicked, we also mimic unconsciously. Now, I mentioned on my very first slide that a fundamental matter of importance is that the brain uses an awful lot of energy resources, about 20% of what the body has available. And what we do know about brains is they don't expend energy uselessly. So what we have to ask is, what's that good for, all that unconscious mimicry? Now, what Chartrand and Borg and others have said is, well, it helps affiliation. Why does it help affiliation? Why do we socially affiliate? In other words, why do I like it if we're in a room and you mimic me? What is that for? Why does my nucleus accumbens care? Now, my answer is this. Now, this is going to be another sort of separate component, but you'll see in a moment they're all going to come together. Consider, let's go back to what we think is the origin of mammalian sociability, infant mother. And one of the things that all parents do, and they can't help it, is they love it when their child imitates them. You smile, and the first time that infant smiles, you just get this. And so on. Now, why is that? Why do we like that? Why do we care that our infant waves when we wave, or smiles when we smile, or says, why do we care that? Now, it looks like the chimps care, although in actual fact, we were talking about this, but it's not clear how much they care, because I don't think it's been studied as well as it might have been. But we really care. And here's my hypothesis about why we care. Imitation is the best predictor you've got that you're talking about, that you're dealing with a normal social brain. It's normal with respect to its mirror neurons that can assess my goals and so forth. And it's normal with respect to all of those critical subcortical structures. If you've got an infant that cannot imitate, that's not interested in imitating, won't imitate, it's the best predictor you've got that this may be a bad investment, to put it in biological terms. And in the ancestral condition, bear in mind, when life is very, very hard and you're living on the knife edge, issues of investment make a big difference. So I think, although I didn't talk about mirror neurons yesterday, maybe I should just say a little bit about them now. It's a kind of misnomer, but since everybody uses it, I'll use it too. The group in the Rizzolatti lab discovered about 10 years ago that there are certain neurons that have the following property, that they are tuned, that is, they get very active when they see you make a particular action, but also when I make that particular action. Now, this was kind of a surprise because hitherto we had seen neurons that respond visually and others that respond to my motor action, but not ones that do both. The hypothesis, and this has not yet been determined, so, you know, be cautious about it. The hypothesis is that when I see you do something, like, that part of what happens is that my motor system kind of simulates that. In fact, in some cases, you may actually copy it. And that allows me to assess what you feel and to predict what you will do because I can get information about what I will do. So that it plays a very important role in the social domain. Now, it's very important that we don't know exactly what that role is yet, and we don't really know as much about the physiology of those neurons and how they relate to other things, but they seem to be an important part of what it is for me to know what your intention is and what your goals and expectations and feelings and so forth are. They probably have something non-trivial to do with empathy and sympathy and all of that. So a part of the story then is that we have these mirror neurons, and a part of the story is that there's all this oxytocin and vasopressin that regulates social behavior. What about non-conscious mimicry then? What about mimicry between strangers? Why do we like that? Well, I think that the basic way to understand it is something like this. Suppose that I want to join your troop. And let's suppose that you're a bit like the chimps, and it's the females who lead their troop, and the males in this troop are by and large interconnected. So I want to join your troop, but suppose this male also wants to join your troop. Now you're interested in having me join the troop because I like his babies. What about him? He wants to join. Well, suppose that what he does is kind of behave just like you. Why would you like that? Well, for the same reason that parents like an imitative infant. It's the best prediction you've got that he's a normal brain, that he's not going to run amok and do terrible things. And also, if we then go into an interaction where he gets a lot of oxytocin and I get a lot of oxytocin, it's like he's an honorary brother. He's honorary kin. And suddenly, these two guys have a bond. Well, what good is that? Well, it's good for this guy because he doesn't want to be a loner. But it may also, and now we get back to goals, it may also be good for the group. Because if he's big and strong and he's loyally bound, he's like my brother, he can help in the lethal intergroup interactions. We're more likely to be successful if we accept outside males into the group who are strong and can fight and who will be intensely loyal, and we can measure that by seeing whether or not they fit in. And whether or not they fit in is going to be a function of whether or not they have the appropriate social brains. I grew up in a very small town, and occasionally a little farming village. And occasionally, somebody would come into the village that nobody knew. And I'm probably embellishing my memory here, but what I do remember is that sometimes these people would interact quite well, and they would be given work and accepted into the village. And other people, somehow, you know, people would say, you know, don't get too friendly with him, he's weird. And then he would be on his merry old way. And I like to, when I've been thinking about this particular problem, I was remembering those people in the village sort of assessing, is this person going to work out? and wondering exactly, you know, what they were using. And I think that these imitative behaviors where there's lots of eye contact and smiling and similarity of body movement, the brain does like those because they are predictive of this will be a good bonding member in the group. Now, once you get larger groups, then you, of course, are able to win in these lethal intergroup competitions. What's in it for the kin as well as the non-kin, and Bolus is right about this, is that we all share the spoils, kin and non-kin alike. Now, when I tried this out on Peter Gardenforce, his question was, then why not chimps? Now, I think that, if I can just go back to this one, increasing group size via integration. I think, but this is the part that I'm really not sure of, and I now have to go back and rethink it by looking at what the literature says. But what I recall is that the hypothesis about early hominins was that with the change of weather in Africa, many of them had to leave the deeply forested areas and went into the savanna. And amongst other things, what happened was their eating habits changed enormously and the groups got larger. And you can imagine that if what you are is a migratory group, you can handle a larger number of members than if you are like the chimps, where basically they don't get beyond a certain troop size of about 15 to 20. That's pretty much it. It's been like that since anybody ever observed them, and they stay like that. They don't amalgamate. Humans do. All right. So my hypothesis here then is that imitation in affiliative behavior, and some of it might be overt, and some of it might not, but it predicts a normal social brain. And if we are as intensely social and need each other as much as this story suggests, then predicting whether or not someone has a normal social brain is extremely important. I remember, actually, this is kind of an interesting story. I guess he was actually a Cree Indian who had been up in the very far north in an Inuit village. And somehow one of the Inuit, who was a good, strong, normal, social person, was bitten by a rabid dog and became, of course, very ill and very crazy and very, very dangerous. Miguel.
Can you explain the word kith? I don't know what it means.
Oh, okay. The kith are the non-kin members of your group.
Okay.
Yeah, right. So you and I, we'd be kith, right? But we're not kin. Yeah, sorry about that. Yeah, kith and kin. Hey, is that a Scottish word? Yeah, probably is. Okay. Yeah, thank you. Yeah, please do, if anything is obscure, and there probably certainly will be things. So, in new members, then, imitative behavior predicts you've got a normal social brain. This person is like us, he will be bonded to us, and he will be loyal. Especially in the defense of the group and when we are in attack. And since both of those things seem to be really important to early hominid groups, both the defense and the attack, then I think that it's an important element of the story. So the hypothesis that I'm proposing is that assuming lethal group interaction, not unlike the kind that we see in chimps, but with a difference, the gene for, roughly speaking, bonding via honorary kin, accepting a stranger as one of us, that gene will spread throughout the population. So that's the hypothesis. And it all depends really on this idea that group membership is really important, but carefully guarded. And it is so given the external conditions that require both defense of this group and sometimes, of course, people, early hominids, appear to have cooperated and traded with other groups, but certainly they often attacked. And so why not chimps? Hominids moved out of the jungles. They were much more nomadic, and that allows for a larger group size. And a larger group size is a good idea if we need to protect ourselves and so forth. And you could sustain larger groups, especially also if you had tool development, and there is reason to think that there was, of course, early tool development for digging roots, but then there were other kinds of tool development as well. And as I said, there are data now suggesting that even very early hominids interacted in trade. They probably made certain kinds of coalitions, but those coalitions, too, would depend very much on, I don't want to just trust you, right? I want to be darn sure that you aren't going to take advantage of me. And so there's that kind of jockeying. I mean, we still see it amongst nations. We still see it in many levels of social behavior, where I have to find out more about you, and I have to find out whether you're, you know, kind of creepy, or, you know, whether this is going to work, to put it. And in these kinds of interactions, they probably did share things like knowledge of wells, perhaps knowledge of prey, and perhaps traded back and forth. Okay, so morality from a biological perspective. So this is where I'm really going, and this is the great passion of my life right now. Is I think it isn't a matter of pure reason. That the fundamental platform has to do with these very important neurochemicals, but others as well, including the endogenous endorphins, various hormones, certainly dopamine and the reward system. And of course, the reward system about which we know such a teeny tiny fragment that it's one of the great exciting frontiers for neuroscience and psychology right now. It almost certainly uses mirror neurons. Although in autism it has been shown that mirror neuron, as they say, system is not normal. That's almost certainly a side effect of a much deeper cause, but Petra is the one who knows more about that than I do. Morality almost certainly involves bonding using unconscious imitation. And the bonding between unrelated males, as we know from many, many war stories, can be extremely strong, extremely intense. They're very, very loyal to each other. And choice, to go back to the talk on free will, choice is a constraint satisfaction problem. It isn't a problem that is solved by reasoning through in the predicate calculus or using a syllogism. It's a matter of a whole lot of constraints exerting their interactions on one another and the network falling into a local minimum where a decision is made. And I think that's my last, oh, not quite. So, brain-based values, the summary slide, evolution sets the style of the brain's drives and emotions. And then experience, both in the natural and the social setting, shapes that style into specific habits, specific sort of conventions, and preferences using the reward system. So if you have been raised in a family where, you know, you were frowned upon for licking your knife, or you were smacked for licking your knife at the dinner table, then when you see someone lick their knife, you just have that feeling. Licking your knife doesn't really matter one way or the other, so why? The reward system doesn't know that. The reward system was trained up, so you see someone licking their knife and you just kind of have that funny feeling. Or others. Okay, well, I talked about rules yesterday, so I'm just going to make this the last slide.
And I would be grateful if you would either augment the story, because I think there's an awful lot. This is covering a huge amount of ground, and there's a lot I don't know, and I'm eager to know what you know. But I'm also eager to know whether you think that this tells a coherent story.